speaker today is Dr. Suzanne E. McDonald. Suzanne is currently a university professor in the Department of Psychology at York University, appointed to the graduate programs in both psychology and biology. She has three main areas of research expertise, including memory and cognition, how animals think, the psychological well-being of captive animals, and the impact of human activity on wildlife. Her research is conducted both in the field at sites in Kenya and throughout Canada, as well as the Toronto Zoo, where she's volunteered as a behaviorist for over 25 years. So let's hand it over to Suzanne.
Well, thank you very much. I hope you can hear me okay. I wish I was there in person with everybody as we had planned, but COVID has other plans. So unfortunately, we're on Zoom again. I seem to spend my whole life on Zoom, and I hope that you can bear with me. I've tried to make this as short as possible so that your rear ends don't fall asleep while I'm talking, but we will go through talking about some opossums. I know lots of you in the Zoom already know about opossums. I'm just going to share some facts and talk about what I'm doing. Last time I talked to TFN, I was talking about raccoons, which of course are fantastic and I still love them, but opossums need more love, I think. Raccoons get a lot of love in Toronto, but we have a newcomer in our city, and it's the opossums. So that's what I'm going to talk about today. I think we can have questions at the end because it's going to be impossible for me to monitor the chat while I'm talking. So please put your questions in the chat and we'll have tons of time at the end. I know you have your AGM afterwards, but I'm going to go through as quickly as I possibly can. Okay, so I'm going to share my screen now. Share. And I hope that is showing up. Thumbs up, Sinead. All right, good. We're ready to go. Okay. So I'm talking about opossums in Canada. This is exciting. I think they're just the weirdest little lovely things. And I just wanted to share with you and have a chat with you because I know some of you know a lot about opossums. So that's, I want to learn from you too. This is Virginia. This is my opossum in my backyard. It's not a very original name given that these are Virginia opossums, but I call her Virginia. And there she is in my backyard. So today I'm going to talk about the natural history of opossums, which many of you know, I'm sure, but if not, you will. Didelphus virginiana, so Virginia opossums. Talk about opossums in Toronto and the rest of Canada. I'll give a little history about how this happened and how we can help opossums, which I think is the most important thing. Now, these are the questions that I get all the time from people, not you, because I know you know the difference, but students ask me this all the time. They're like, oh, opossums are so cute. They're from Australia. No, they're not. So the American opossum, the North American opossum, is not the same as the Australian opossum, who is undoubtedly very cute. Opossums are opossums, although in the US, you may know that they call them possums, but they're actually opossums. And the Australian possums were named after opossums. So they it wasn't like Americans said, oh, we're going to call them opossums after the Australians. It was the other way around. So we are talking about these crazy looking little things on the right, not the adorable little Australian possums on the left. And they are Canada's only marsupial. So pretty exciting. And I saw in the list of participants, we have urban marsupial. So that's fantastic. I love that. So they're marsupials, they're not true mammals, but they're, you know, they're marsupials. What can we say? So they give birth after a 12-day gestation period. It's really short. And there's a reason for that. I'm going to show you a video. Okay. So this is an opossum that was hit by a car. It's at a wildlife center in the US. And she's undergoing surgery. There she is. And you can see she has a pouch full. Hey,
Suzanne, we're not seeing your video.
Oh, for fiddly frick. Oh my God, how am I supposed to share the video if I can't show you the video? Okay, let's figure this one out. It says I'm screen sharing.
You might have to select the specific app under share.
Well, it's YouTube, so.
Yeah, okay, or the browser.
if I get out of this and get into this, let's see. We got to figure this out because I got a lot of videos. There. Can you see it now?
Nope.
Okay, share screen. Here we go. Okay. I'm going to share this.
There we go.
You should be able to see it. Okay. So let me just get back to the beginning. This is in a wildlife center, and this little female was hit by a car, and she's having surgery. And they are showing you her little pouch full of baby opossums. And that's what they look like. Is that not the weirdest thing ever? They look like little tiny wriggly worms. And they're in there because her gestation period is so short. It's only 12 days. They're like little grains of rice, and they crawl up into her pouch and they sit in there until they're ready to go. So let me get out of here and back into here. Oh, this is going to be annoying. I'm gonna have to do this every time. Okay, so just like in the Australian marsupials, the babies are called joeys, which is confusing, which is, I guess, why people confuse them with opossums from Australia. And they grow super fast. So you saw those little tiny squirmy little worms. Their birth weight.
Suzanne, sorry to interrupt you again, but
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, we're just seeing a frozen YouTube screen.
Jesus Christ. Okay, let me get out of here. Hold on. This is so annoying. I'm so sorry. Okay.
Hey, the joys of technology.
Yeah, it's very frustrating for you, and I'm sorry about that. So we'll try this again. Can you see my screen now?
Not yet.
Okay, hold on. Slideshow. Well, it's going to take longer. Can you see it? Could you see it? Oh, for God's sake. Can you see it now?
Nope.
No. What is happening here? Please wait. I'm so sorry. Okay, we'll go back to here and we'll go back to Zoom. Oh my God. And we're going to share the screen. We're going to figure this out. Come hell or high water, I'm going to figure this out. Okay. Now, can you see it?
Yes, we can.
All righty then. Oh my God, I'm going to have to go back and forth. Oh well. Okay, so babies are called joeys. They grow super fast. You saw that they were teeny tiny, and they increase 10 times in size in a week. So when they are born, when they're in the pouch, there can actually be like 20 of them. But the mother only has nipples for 13. So this is like natural selection at its finest here, that only 13 can possibly survive. So no matter how many little squirmy worms she's got in there, only 13 are going to make it out. And after a couple of months, they get way too big for the pouch and they come out on her back, which I think is just adorable. You can see how this poor female looks a little bit shell-shocked by all these little squirmy things on top of her, but you can see how big they've grown. These ones are just about ready to leave, but even when they are smaller, they do take up a lot of her back. I see them on the campus at York quite a bit with females wandering around. It's like she's a little bus, you know, with all these babies stuck on top of her. They're super, super cute when they're little. And for those of you who work in wildlife rehab, you know that when they're small, when they're less than like 7 inches, they're not going to survive. It's very difficult to feed them because the nipples inside are really, really thin and very hard to replicate when you're trying to feed. You can't bottle feed them because they just, the nipples are too big for them. So it's very, I find it challenging to rehab these, but once they're a little bit bigger like this, then you can actually rehab them. So that's this female. And this is the little babies, because why not look at little babies? Because they're darn cute. So, oh, I have a video. Oh, should we try it? Well, so they have prehensile tails, you can see. So they're grabbing onto the stick, and they have their little toes have little opposable thumbs. They're not really thumbs, but they can grip really well. I'm going to try, because why not? Let's just see what happens here. I'm going to.
However you holiday, Hudson's Bay has you covered.
That sound, and I'm going to get out of here. And I'm going to get into here. I'm going to have to figure this out quickly and do this thing. We're going to share my screen. And we're going to share this screen. And we're going to do this.
We've got your hosting and decor commercial. Outfits and beauty that'll bring joy to your world. Yeah, and gifts from under $25 to special splurges.
I'm going to skip that, skip the ad. Okay, this is just showing you an opossum, which you may have seen in your backyard, but this is an opossum using her prehensile tail to take leaves, grab leaves up and put them into her little den. I just think it's the cutest thing ever. And that's what they do. They use their tail for all sorts of things. And that's one of the things. So let's see if I can switch back to, stop this. There's many opossum videos on the internet. I can tell you that right now. Okay, really? We're gonna get back into it. This is gonna be so annoying for you. Okay. So I'm
all good. You're doing good.
Maybe you might be able to see this if I share this. Can you see this? Nope. Let's go back to this. Hold on. We're coming. Share screen. Okay. I'm not going to play the next video because. Okay. Can you see that?
Yes.
Excellent. Thank you. Good thing you're there to tell me. Okay. So they make really interesting vocalizations. I'm not going to show you the video because it's just not worth it, but they do. So they have a range of vocalizations, and I'll just mimic them. Because if you hear them in your backyard, you might say, what the heck is that? So the mothers, when they're separated from their babies, they go click like that. And the babies, when they're separated from their mother, they sneeze. I can't sneeze on command, but it's like choo, 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 and you hear in reply. So it's an amazing thing if you're listening for that sometimes at night, especially in the spring, you might hear that and you hear them clicking. They also do that when they're mating. So they have some really interesting vocalizations that don't sound like what you would expect to come out of an animal like that, but that's what comes out of them. So around 5 months or so, they're on their own. They go off, they mate, they breed, they do all the things. They can have two litters or two or three litters a year. So they can have a lot of babies. Reproductive wise, this is the male's penis. What? What kind of thing is that? So this thing here, they have bifurcated penises. So the females have bifurcated reproductive organs as well. It's a very interesting evolutionary thing. So the uterus is bifurcated, the lateral vaginal canals, and so the penis is actually bifurcated too. So not something you see. I mean, you can see it in snakes and see it in some other animals, but you don't expect it in an animal like that. So very unusual in many respects. And here's another respect where they're unusual. They have 50 teeth. That's the most, that's a lot of teeth, and they are very strange looking. So this is what an opossum looks like when they have their mouth open. And I think this is probably, why people are afraid of them, because they have an awful lot of teeth. And you don't want to be on the other end of those teeth, but I have never seen one bite anybody ever. I've never even heard of that before, but they do have a lot of teeth. And when they display them like that, this is a threat display or an alarm display, they are quite impressive. Oops. So they do have impressive teeth, but they're scavengers and opportunists. They're not they will eat other animals for sure. If they can, they can kill chickens in a most disturbing fashion. But they're not predators. So they're not like coyotes, they're not like wolves, they're not like even raccoons or generalists, but they will hunt things down and get them. But they're kind of opportunistic scavengers, I would call them. So they don't have any defenses. They are super shy and they look threatening, but they really don't have much going on. So when they are threatened, they play dead. Now I was going to show you a video here, but I'll just act it out for you because it'll be a lot easier. So you may have seen an opossum play dead, and certainly playing possum is what, that's a very sort of standard phrase in the US for playing dead when you play possum. Again, it's not opossum, but they are opossums. So when they are threatened, they actually fall over and they look like they're completely dead. They're not actually playing at it. Their brain has cut them off. So it's not like they're looking with one eye going, is that predator gone? It's usually a dog, let's be honest. That's a video I was going to show you with some Yahoo guy. Said, hey, go get him, Rocky. And the dog comes up to the opossum. The opossum just goes whoomp on the side and just looks like it's dead. The opossum is not playing. The opossum is unconscious and not there and emits a very distinctive odor that other animals see as a dead animal. So if you had seen this video, which I will now act out for you, Rocky goes up to the opossum and then goes like that because the opossum is emitting the smell. So dogs don't eat dead animals and they usually give it pretty wide berth. So that's what their defense is, that they play dead. They play opossum. And then after, it can take a long time for them to come back to consciousness, and then they get up, yoink, and they walk away, which is wild. So, you know, they don't have a lot of ability to fend off other animals, but this works pretty darn well. And, you know, they've been around a really long time and it seems to do the job for them. They also, and, you know, when I talk about raccoons, I talk about, oh, they can get into everything. You know, they get into the garage, they get into the attic, they get under your deck, they get everywhere. Opossums may be under your deck for sure, but they don't build their own dens. That little video I showed you of the opossum with the leaves in her tail, which I think is amazing. She's just getting leaves to sleep on. So she brings them to a place that usually that other animals have made. So for me, Virginia lives underneath my front doorstep, and a skunk lives under there too, which is really interesting. And they're both under there. So Virginia comes out and gathers leaves and puts them down and makes it all cozy. And she uses that. So they're not out digging dens. They're not getting into your house. They're not getting into your attic. They're not doing any of those things. They're opportunistic denners as well. So they use whatever they can find to have as shelter. So they're not destructive to property like raccoons are. They are not gonna, you know, get in your attic and drive you nuts with babies screaming at the middle of the night, none of that stuff. So they aren't like that. There is a pretty, I would say almost like an urban legend that they eat ticks. So everybody says, oh, well, opossums are good because they eat ticks. I say it too, because I don't want people to hurt opossums. And somebody said they can eat up to 5,000 ticks in a summer. Okay. So I checked that, and there's really no data on that at all. I think somebody kind of made that up. And that's fine, because it keeps people from hurting the opossums. They probably do eat ticks, but it's not like they're out there like a tick killing machine where they're looking for ticks and they're going to denude an area of ticks. They will eat whatever they find, but they're probably not eating 5,000 ticks. It would be a really strange spot to have 5,000 ticks. I can't imagine whose yard has 5,000 ticks in it. If that's the case, there's a bigger problem than having opossums in there, but they do eat ticks for sure. And you can tell people they eat 5,000 ticks in a season if you like, but I really haven't been able to find any evidence of this. What I didn't put up there is they do seem to be immune to rattlesnake bite. So they will kill snakes, which is great. I find that I'm not a huge snake man. And they can get bitten and they don't die, which is amazing. So they have some really great superpowers to allow them to eat whatever dead things they find, whatever they find, and to not get attacked by other animals as much as you would expect for a little animal that doesn't have that many defenses of their own. So where do they live? Okay, so this is from the Canadian Encyclopedia. This was the in the orange there is the range of the opossum. And that's up to date. So you can see that it's mostly Eastern and Central US, mostly in the South. The Western ones were introduced. So people brought them across, probably in wagon trains and however, some of them brought them on purpose, I guess. But you can see there's a big swath there near in the West where there's no opossums. And you can see that most of Canada has no opossums whatsoever. So I have a little urban iNaturalist opossum thing going on here. And so I was just going to show you, this is a map of just Canada, and the orange outline is the map of Canada. And you can see here, I hope you can see my cursor, these are everybody who has put up a picture of an opossum comes up as an orange spot. So you can see that the vast majority of them are in Southern Ontario. There's a, I'll close up in a minute, and there's just a few in BC. So I'm gonna close up here on BC. So the border is here, right? So they can actually come across. So what I'm doing right now, is I have cameras up all in White Rock and that area, trying to find out where they're coming across and how many there are, what the density is. So far, it's really low because I have had cameras up for a year and I haven't seen any, but other people have reported seeing them. I don't know how that opossum that's in West Vancouver, which is up here, possibly got up to West Vancouver, but you know, in the city of Vancouver, I know that nobody has seen any opossums and I haven't either, but down here closer to the US border, there are a few. And if you go up here, Chilliwack and South Surrey, there are a few sightings, but not very many. But you may say, oh, there's one in Parksville. Mm-hmm. And look over here on Hornby Island. What? What has happened there? Well, I'm here to tell you what has happened there. So in the mid 80s, a couple, why, I don't know, brought in a couple of opossums from the US to their summer home, and they let them go. And since the mid 80s, like 1986, those opossums have reproduced at quite a high rate, completely unchecked, because the native wildlife in Hornby Island is not prepared for opossums. So the opossums at, I would say even up to 10 years ago, were a huge problem on Hornby Island because there were so many. There are reports of people coming out to their backyard and seeing 10 at the same time, all in trying to get into the chicken house, the hen house. They did kill chickens. They were everywhere. And just like we in Toronto see raccoons in our garbage, people in Hornby Island would come out to put their garbage in the garbage can and there'd be opossums in there. And they are rooting through the garbage for the whatever they can find, because of course they are in a, on an island that doesn't have a lot of resources. So they had to eat everything. So that's why there are opossum sightings on Hornby Island. And I'm assuming there's one in Parksville as well. Somebody must have brought one over, but you know, there's just a couple on Vancouver Island. So I'm not sure even, they are verified sightings. So I'm not quite sure. I don't think they're swimming from Hornby over to Vancouver Island, but somebody must have brought opossums over with them in a truck or something. So Hornby, it has been a big problem. And I do field work out in BC. I'm going out on Tuesday again. And it's a fascinating thing because you bring an invasive species into an island and the island is not prepared and they're there. Luckily, over the past few years, the population seems to have decreased a bit. What they think is that some sort of disease has gone through the population. I'm not sure what, because opossums aren't susceptible to all that much. But they seem to have not be complaining so much about opossums in Hornby Island anymore. But you can see it's kind of wild to see that opossums are in an island in the middle of the water. And that's why. So that's your interesting fact for the day, is that they've actually made it to Hornby Island. So I will update after I've seen more opossums in BC, but they definitely, there's a few here and there. I haven't seen any even roadkill, and roadkill is always a great indicator of that there's enough animals to have a density that some are being killed by the road on the roads, and I haven't seen any roadkill, but I keep monitoring. So this is the same map with all the sightings in Southern Ontario. So you can see that, wow, there's a whole lot in Toronto, and you can see all the way down to Windsor, and you can all the way over to Fort Erie and a few around Montreal now. I have cameras up in Ottawa because there's not very many there. There was one sighted in the west of Ottawa, but I have cameras up in the east to see if they're gonna be in that Ottawa-Montreal corridor, and so far, nothing so far. So you can see that they're quite ubiquitous. I remember the first time I saw an opossum, I was standing outside of McDonald's on Yonge Street at Lawrence at, 2 in the morning, please do not ask. And everyone was gathered around and said, there's a giant rat in the gutter. And so I went to look, it was like 1996. I went to look and I was like, I don't think that's a rat. I think that's an opossum, but how could it possibly be in Toronto? Because so I remember the day very well, because I thought that someone had put an opossum in the gutter on Yonge Street. It was very strange. So that's where I trace opossums to the 90s, that's when they started coming. I don't know how that particular one got on Yonge Street at Lawrence, but it did. And you can see that there certainly are a lot of opossums in the Greater Toronto area and all the way through Southern Ontario. And they've even made it up to Wasaga Beach. Now I was going to show this really cute video by this lovely fellow, Reg, who sent me videos from his backyard. I'll act it out for you. He has set up a little mini picnic table, like this big, and he's nailed it to the fence and he puts food on it. It's really cute. But you shouldn't do this, but it's very cute. So the opossum that lives under his deck comes up and goes and sits on his little picnic table and gets his food every night. So it's up in Wasaga Beach, and you know, he gets a lot of snow. He was showing that certainly there's lots of snow in his area and the opossum was making it through the winter. So, you know, I think we can thank climate change, because this species can extend their range north, further north than ever before. And now they are clearly in Southern Ontario and Wasaga Beach and up a little bit higher. They're not in other parts of Canada, but I imagine that will happen. But if you go back to that big map where there's a large part of the Midwest where there's no opossums, they're not going to come from there. But certainly BC is a good opossum land, because it doesn't get cold, there's not much snow. They're not supposed to be over there, but they are. And certainly Southern Ontario, as we get warmer and warmer winters, I think we'll have more and more opossums moving in. And that's why I'm kind of interested in the Ottawa area, because they do get a lot of snow. You do see opossums in the snow. It's a lovely one, but they don't like it so much. So I'm kind of with them on that. They don't like the snow, and they're not adapted to the snow. So because they have these little ears that stick out, and they have those rat-like tails, they are very susceptible to frostbite on their ears and their tails, and they can die from frostbite. So Toronto Wildlife Center, bless their hearts, takes in opossums every year in Toronto that have had frostbite on their ears and their tail. And so you may see opossums like this looking a little rough. You can see ears are a little mangy looking, but it's actually just frostbite. And you can tell, I mean, they have bare hands, right? So it looks like they're wearing little fingerless gloves to me, because it's dark here and their little pink fingers stick out, but they're not set up for extended cold periods and extended a lot of snow. So this is something that is a problem. So last winter, a student of mine, Parth Shah, who's from India, he's an international student, and he's a graphic design student. He was at OCAT. He's graduated now. He's doing his master's. He contacted me and said he was interested in doing something to help animals. And I said, well, what an amazing coincidence. I'm doing this crazy ass thing in my backyard right now. Parth, you can come and help me. And I said, we're going to try to build shelters for opossums. And he said, oh, great, we can test out different ones so we can see what they like. So we basically did a user test for opossums to see what kind of shelters they liked. And that's because he's a design student. He was supposed to test things with humans, but he decided to go with opossums as well instead. So I thought that was really cute. So we spent a lot of money at Home Depot, and we constructed shelters. These are just big old Rubbermaid boxes that we insulated, that with styrofoam. We put nesting material, because you see they do like nesting material. We had a little door cut, and we had different sizes. We had different types of material. We had different locations. We tested out a bunch of things. This is just a picture from my backyard. So this is a test of size. So the one on the right, the black one, is larger than the one on the left. The opening is small enough so that raccoons don't like it. We tried that too. So we got to the point where a raccoon wouldn't go in there, which was important. And the cat, local cats weren't going in there. We weighted them down with stones and put in nesting material. And then I just put cameras up just to see, oh no, oh, this is in the video. This is good. This is in my presentation. I don't have to escape. I can show you video. That's great. Anyway, so this is where we tried it out. This Thornhill one is mine, my house. And then these are just friends that I convinced to let me do crazy things in their backyard. And we just tried it out just to see what they would like. And I will show you, because I can actually show you this one. So this is Virginia in my backyard. You can see she's having a nice little time. I forget what date this is, but it was like October. You can see her waddling around. She's not thin, is Virginia. She's doing well. And she's checking out the shelter. So there's two there. You're just seeing the left one on the video. And she walked by and then she went, wait a minute. You can see the eye shine as she comes back. And she's going to go in. I'm telling you now, spoiler alert. Now you can't really see because it is a infrared, but she's going in. There's that tail going in. And she's going to turn around. Just a second, wait for the eye shine. There she is. She's in. So that's how we measured preference. And then she came out. We measured preference by whether they went in and tried it and if they stayed there and came back and did all those good things. So that's Virginia in the backyard. There she is again. So on the fence. So just to tell you what happened. So we kind of did it a little too late in the year. I think it wasn't cold enough. So we had opossums investigate all the things. What they liked was the larger one. And they liked the one with substrate that was movable, so leaves and straw. I had some straw. They liked that. And they liked locations where they were safe, so that the back was up against something. So you can't just put it in the middle of the yard. It has to be up against something, preferably with stuff on top of it. Ideally, I think this winter, I think I'm going to try and bury some of them because I think they might like that better. And we'll give it a try. But that was just our prototype. And Parth got his master's, which is all that really matters. But it was very fun and kind of interesting to be able to give them the choice to see what they wanted to, where they wanted to shelter. And hopefully we'll continue that this year. So yeah, great. Help them out in the winter. That's wonderful. But what about their public image? And this was actually the focus of Parth's paper, was how we're gonna make Toronto fall in love with the opossum. This, I take you back to Rob Ford. 2015, this was a Toronto Sun article that infuriated me. I was quoted in it because I was infuriated by it. Possums, not opossums, notice, not raccoons, are the city's real problem. So he goes on to state with absolutely no evidence that they're disgusting, that they're terrible, that they're going to eat everything, that they're vicious, that all these things. Oh my God, no evidence whatsoever. So of course, Toronto Sun interviewed quite a few of us and we all said the same thing. I'm like, what are you talking about, Rob? This is insane. Like, come on. Maybe read a book before you go out there and say that opossums are a big problem for us. It was not true. Now, I totally get that people look at them and some people go, oh my God, they're hideous. I find that really cute. But Parth decided that we should do a merchandise search to see what kind of merchandise is out there. I don't know if you've gone on Amazon and look for anything raccoon related, but there are thousands of things on Amazon that are raccoon related. They're super cute and earrings and necklaces and pillows and every possible thing, which somehow I have in my house, everything. So we thought we'd look at Amazon for opossums as well. And it turns out that just in the past few years, and I think this is post-pandemic, that opossums have been adopted as a mascot for several communities. So these are just a few of the t-shirts that are out there. They are, you know, live weird, fake your death. Okay. Apparently that's the thing for people. Opossums also are seen as anxious animals because they do open their mouths, ah, yeah, and they look like they're nervous all the time. So social anxiety, folks with social anxiety actually have adopted the opossum as their mascot. And so they have, you know, shirts that say, I'm anxious, leave me alone. And this thing, I think it's hilarious. So that community also is out there and likes opossums. And then the ever popular, let's eat trash and get hit by a car. I don't understand this one, but I know the queer community has adopted them. That they're an unusual species. And I think they feel like it's a marginalized species. And so they have been adopted by some communities. So there are subsets of people, and these are Americans, I'm willing to bet any money, that because they have a lot more opossums and a lot more experience, that have taken the opossums on as their own. And there are opossum groups, and there are opossum sub chats and Reddit subreddits and all the things about opossums. People are getting into opossums. So Parth and I thought this was really cool, that maybe we could do the same. And here's another one, Eat the Rich, which is, you know, there you go. So it's kind of like, you know, the spunky newcomer, spunky outlier, marginalized person against the mainstream, kind of. That's what we're getting at here with these merchandise items, which are available freely on Amazon. This is not sponsored by Amazon. I receive no money from Amazon from affiliate links. So we think that positioning opossums as newcomers might be helpful. So Parth, as a newcomer himself from India, said, look, just like me, they're shy, they're anxious, and they don't know how to deal with the winter. And so I thought that was pretty great that we developed a little campaign that we're going to show the city of Toronto about how we can position opossums as newcomers that need our help, that we need to help them get used to Canada. And that we need to be aware that they're anxious and that they don't want you to cuddle them. They just want to be left alone and to do their own thing. So I'm hopeful that we can actually make an impact on how opossums are viewed, certainly in the GTA, because it's a big population, as you can see from that map. There's a lot of people seeing opossums. So there are other ways to help. Of course, you can get the word out yourself. You can tell your friends and neighbors, and please tell politicians. I don't know if Doug Ford feels the same as his brother did, but I certainly appreciate their weird beauty. And I think Teresa, who's in the audience today, also appreciates their weird beauty. She wrote this article and sent it to me on Give Opossums a Chance, Reducing Urban Mortality, which is amazing. And I just think this is a great article, so I'm sharing it. I know you can't read it. It's very small. I just wanted to shout out to Teresa. In person, I would have done it. But, you know, sending you a virtual hug, Teresa. And also Lynn, who wrote this awesome opossum poem, Opossum by Moonlight. I will not read it to you because that would just be cringeworthy, but I will tell you that this is a beautiful poem. And I think having folks like you in the audience getting the word out about opossums will really, really help. We need to tell people that, yeah, they're weird looking, they're beautiful. We should be happy that they're here. We should welcome them with open arms and tell them they eat ticks. That'll do it. So this is a good poster. I stole this from the US. So just say, look, I'm an opossum. I'm not going to hurt you. I look scary, but I don't. I just want to raise my babies. I just want to survive. And I think that's all they're trying to do in the GTA, and that's what we can collectively help them do. So that's all. Thank you so much for listening. And now I'm happy to take questions from the chat.
Thank you very much, Susan.
Okay.
So, Peter, are there any questions in the chat?
Not yet.
Oh, I see 12 things in
there. There we go.
Okay.
Lots of people have seen them.
I see one.
Yes.
Nope.
Maybe people could put their hands up if you've seen them.
So we got one here. Do you position the entrance of the shelters to the south?
Well, that's a good question. We did try that. It didn't seem to make a difference. It was mostly positioning the entrance so that they could access it and it was protected from the wind, and that they for whatever reason felt secure. So they really did like it when they were against a fence. It didn't matter which fence it was. They just liked to have it in the corner. I moved them up into a real corner and they liked the corner a lot. So I'll tell you more after we try it again, but no, the south didn't seem to make a difference.
Okay. And then we, before we get to the folks with their raised hands, we have another question in the chat. What is their lifespan?
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't actually know. In like raccoons, you know, can live 16 years in captivity, get 20 years in captivity, and they live 2 years, maybe if they're lucky in the wild. And I think that's probably the case for opossums as well. They don't live as long as they should in urban settings because they get hit by cars. Oh my God, one of my students is texting me. He's at the zoo. I cannot believe it. I hope you can't hear that. He's just sending like endless texts at me. So I actually don't know. But I know that in our area, it's quite reduced because I know that not very many of them make it through the winter. So I would think that the vast majority make it through 1 year, and then when the winter hits, they're not around. I think in 50 years, that'll change because, you know, natural selection will do its thing, and they'll be much more winter adapted. But right now they are not making it through the winter. So they don't last very long.
Ginny had her hand raised at one point. Do you have a question?
She might've just been raising hands saying she'd seen an opossum.
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
Rosie also had her hand raised, and then Barry S. Ellen has a question, would they den high up in tree hollows?
I think if it was a good enough hollow, they might, because they're good climbers. But I usually see them on the ground or on fences. So, but they do go across wires and they will, you know, they can do that. So I would imagine. I think they might be fighting raccoons for that, though. They don't fight raccoons at all. I'll just tell you this. I did a thing for CBC on opossums and just did a little experiment in my backyard that I cut out because I thought we would have not enough time. And I staked a chicken from Loblaws, one of the rotisserie chickens. I staked it down in the backyard and put cameras up to just see what happened. Of course, the raccoons come first. They pull off the chicken breasts and the skin, and then they leave because that's what they want. And then, you know, they'll come back again. Opossums come the very, very last, and they do not take on those raccoons. So I'm thinking if there's raccoons in a hollow, if it's a good hollow, they're not going anywhere near it. So they kind of get the leftovers of everything. That's why I kind of feel sorry for them. So I like them.
It's a question about what they'll eat in the winter.
Oh God, whatever they can find. And that's the thing. If they have enough fat in the fall, they don't actually need to forage. They can probably make it through if the winter isn't that long. And that's what they do in the US, in the more southern areas. So I'm thinking they're actually not finding anything because they come out in January. There's nothing. What are they going to eat? There's absolutely nothing. There's nothing else out when it's super cold. They do come out. It's not like they hibernate. They're active, but they, as long as they put on enough fat in the fall, the estimates are that they can survive based on their body fat, because I don't know what they're eating in the dead of winter when there's nothing on the trees, there's nothing in the ground, and the ground is covered with snow. They can't dig with their little frozen paws.
Another question, what benefit do opossums provide if we encourage their presence in the city? They're not indigenous.
Yeah, they are an invasive species, so I don't know if we could encourage them, but they're certainly here. So we want to make sure the ones that are here are comfortable. That's all I think. And again, they're probably not going to live very long, so it's not like we're going to be overrun like Hornby Island was, where it's warm. Again, tell people they eat ticks, and they probably do eat ticks, and that's helpful, so that's a benefit. It's not that they have any benefits. It's just that they have no... they don't do anything bad. So why not? Like, they're just there trying to make a living. So they're, let them be and be nice to them. And as Teresa has said there, you use heated feral cat shelters and good results. Yeah. Anything you can do to help them out in these super cold days will ensure that they survive, but they're not asking you for anything. So they're not going to come to your back door like a raccoon and knock on the door until you give them food, which is what the ones in my backyard do. They are just out there. And they're just going to do their weirdo thing. And we just have to let them do their weirdo thing. So they're an invasive, but they're not a pest species. They're not destructive.
The question, would they den up in high trees?
Yeah,
or tree hollows?
I think they would if they could, but I don't know if, as I said, the raccoons might take those good spots. If there's a spot, they'll take it. The ones that I have seen, certainly like the one are on the ground, like the ground. They go under the front door, they go under the deck, they go under people's sheds, they go under, and they may den with others as well, other species as well, if there's enough room, not raccoons.
Someone's seen some research that they're very well groomed and this process kills ticks. Have you heard anything along those lines?
In that they groom themselves?
It says they're very well groomed. I guess they're so well groomed that they basically, if anything comes to them, I guess that would probably sort of help in the tick killing area.
For sure. And they are. If you look at one up close, they're beautiful. Like their fur is just beautiful. They do groom themselves with their little, and their toes too. They're good groomers. They're always grooming at themselves. So I'm assuming that they get ticks off themselves. I don't think they're actually up there hunting for ticks, but again, they're opportunistic. So they will eat whatever they can get, but yeah, they are. If they're healthy, they look really good. Their fur looks really, really good.
We got one more question.
Okay.
How do they get along / manage with Norway rats?
I don't know. I haven't on my camera seen any rats at all. So I know Toronto is Rat City. It was published last week. But I haven't picked up any rats at all. And if I were them, I'd give rats a wide berth. Rats have awesome teeth and aren't afraid to use them. So I think they probably don't get involved with rats. You know, they're lovers. They're not fighters, opossums. They're not gonna attack a rat. And I don't think anything should attack a rat. That's for sure. So I have no idea. If I saw any on my camera, I would tell you. But I've not seen anything like that. With the cats, I can tell you though. My cats are like, what the heck is that?
All right, one last question in the chat and then we're going to wrap.
Do they eat carrion?
Yes, they do, for sure. You bet. So they are scavengers, so they'll eat anything they can find, and carrion is absolutely, and they seem to have these iron stomachs that don't get sick from eating things or being bit by rattlesnakes or being, I mean, they're evolutionarily ancient, right? They've evolved to deal with all sorts of stuff. And they can manage eating carrion for sure. I'm looking at this.
One more question.
Okay.
Something about rat poison. Do you see that?
No, I didn't get to that one yet.
Do they ever get poisoned by rat boxes?
Oh, probably not. That's an empirical question. I don't know. I mean, we'd have to see. I haven't seen like carcasses, but you know, they'd probably wander away and die somewhere else. So I don't know. Matt's a good idea. Actually, you should put cameras up there. That's a good idea. I'll do that. Thank you.
Rabies or public health issues?
Yeah, no rabies or public health issues with them.
All righty. Thank you very much, Susan. That was amazing.
Great. I'm glad. Thank you, everybody. Thanks so much for your good questions and happy opossum watching.
And thanks to everybody who's joined us and be sure to come back and check out our December lecture. For all of our members, we will be proceeding into our AGM in 5 minutes. So I will play a lovely slideshow for everybody to watch from our Now and Then project until we start the AGM.